Amen, amen, amen. Praise the Lord, everyone. Praise the Lord, everyone. Amen. Aren't you glad to be in the house of the Lord today? Amen. If we could all stand to our feet today, I'd like to honor some of our veterans. So thankful for our military and the veterans that have served our country and the sacrifices that they've made. I'd like to thank Brother Villain Murray. He has served, he's been serving, he's serving now, and appreciate him. My dad served in the military. Wade Mitchell Sr., like to honor him. Like to also honor Brother Jesse Dowden. I appreciate their service. And if there's anybody else here that has come in, I appreciate all that you've done for our country. Let's give them a hand today. Amen. 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 Man, God is good. Amen. We're going to pledge allegiance to the flag. Put your hand over your heart. Let's pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Amen.
Amen. Amen. So thankful for the freedoms that we have. Amen. We can come into this house, we can worship, we can lift our hands, we can do it the way that we feel in our heart to do it. And I'm thankful for that freedom that we can get loud, we can lift our hands, we can clap our hands with the freedom and the liberty to do it. We don't have to be underground somewhere, but we can come in here with the freedom and glorify the Lord. Amen? So let's do that right now. Let's clap our hands. Let's lift our voices unto the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Lord Jesus, we thank you. God, I thank you, Lord Jesus, for your grace, your love, and mercies, Lord, that are new every day. Come on, let's worship him. He's worthy to be praised. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. If our praise team would come and musicians would come, we're going to worship today. We're going to glorify the Lord. I'm so thankful to live in a country where we have freedom to worship him. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. God, we thank you, Jesus. Come on, let's lift our voices unto the Lord. He's worthy to be praised today. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Can you turn Brother John on? Is he on? All right. There we go. Thank you, Jesus. Thankful for the freedom we have when the piano starts to play. Amen. Let's worship the Lord today.
Promises, we're standing on his promises. In him we have a confidence, 'cause he won't fail, he won't fail.
Come on, aren't you thankful for the goodness and the grace of the Lord today? Come on, the Lord is going before us in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Come on.
He will not forsake us. Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, if you need the Lord to move in your life today, you are in the right place. Come on, lift your hands and your voices unto the Lord. God, have your way today, Jesus. Have your way today, Jesus. Hallelujah. He's the same yesterday, today, forever. If he did it before, he can do it again today. Hallelujah. If you came in discouraged, you can leave here encouraged. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. God, we call out to you, Lord. Bless this place today. God, you know every need, every situation today. Hallelujah. And walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall. Anybody ever feel that way before? For you have never failed me. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. And waiting for change to come, and knowing the battle's won. Thank you, Lord. For you have never failed me yet. Oh, thank you, Lord. Oh, your promise still stands. Great is your faith. Faithful today.
Faithful, yes.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me.
Oh, thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, have your way today.
I know the
Oh, magnify the Lord. Magnify the Lord. It's why we're here today. Oh, magnify him. He's worthy today. Has he been good to you? Has he blessed your soul? God, we lift you up, Jesus. Hallelujah. He's the one that can make a way today. Well, thank you, Lord. Come on, lift him up one more time. We give you all. Can you lift him up from your heart? Oh, things begin to change and begin to bless your soul. Oh, in Jesus' name, hallelujah. God, we love you, Jesus. Come on, the Lord's been good to us today. The Lord's been good to you today. Come on, he's worthy. In Jesus' name, come on. For that promise. Thank you, Lord. Come on.
And come, all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for.
Well, thank you, Lord. Here's why. Hey.
For God so loved the world that he made. He's one and only Son. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world.
Bring all your fears, bring your addictions.
Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved.
Well, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, let's clap our hands unto the Lord. Oh, he's been so good to us. Well, thank you, Jesus. You can be set free today by the blood of the Lamb and the word of your testimony in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Come on, let's just keep that going for the Lord right now. Hallelujah, Jesus, today, God. Lord, you sent your only begotten Son, Lord, that for my sin, God, that I might be saved today, God. Come on, let's just keep that going for the Lord for just a moment. Come on, he made a way when there was no way today, God. Come on, he made a way when there was no, he parted the Red Sea. He healed the sick. Come on, he calmed the storm. Hallelujah today, God. I give you praise, God, in glory and honor today, God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So the scripture says that first song was talking about promises, and the second song was talking about promises. The Bible says the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, but he is long-suffering towards us, that it's his will that none should perish, but all should come to repentance. And I believe it's the will of God. If you have not repented today, all you have to do is lift up your hands, and you can just begin to turn away from your sin and say, Lord, I'm sorry for what I've done. I don't want to walk in that direction of sin anymore, but God, I want to turn away from that sin. And then we have a baptismal tank behind here. If you want to be baptized today, we can baptize you in the name of Jesus for the washing away of your sins. And then God's going to fulfill his promise, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Come on, if you're thankful for that, why don't you clap your hands unto the Lord? Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Amen, amen, amen. You may return back to your seats. We have a special video that we will want to play. If you could direct your attention to the screen right behind me.
Praise the Lord from Thailand.
We put together a quick video of the past month we've had in Thailand. We've had the privilege to travel through the country and visit many churches and make a lot of connections and learn a lot from the culture.
So we just want to say we love you and thank you for your support and prayers, and we miss you all very much. God bless.
Bye.
Thank you.
Let's give it up for Brother Jeff and Sister Monica. We love them. We love what God is, how God is using them through Thailand. They've been gone for a few months. Please keep them in your prayers. Jeff, Monica, not only them, but their children, Ben and Grace. We love them dearly. And not only if you want to continue praying, and also Brother Richard and Sister Lisa Curtin, their grandparents, pray for them. I know they're probably worrying sometimes. Amen. But if you not only would, if you would like to keep them in your prayers, but if you'd like to partner financially with them on your tithe and offering envelope, you can put in the missions Thailand or Jeff and Monica, and all proceeds will go directly to Jeff and Monica in Thailand. Amen. If you remain seated, I have a couple short announcements. Everybody say today. Today there is an NYC meeting today after church. Amen. NYC, how many of you guys are excited for NYC? Amen. NYC is only 10 days away. Amen. I'm so excited for National Youth Convention. We're leaving about 10 days. The first night, Wednesday night, I'm excited to hear from Bishop Steve Wilson. They're celebrating their 50th National Youth Convention. And Bishop Steve Wilson, the first youth president, is going to be starting out the first night. Amen. Next announcement, everybody say this Saturday. This Saturday, there's going to be a service at Clawson Manor, and our worship service starts at 10 a.m. So, our Clawson, 10:30, it says 10 a.m., I'm sorry, I thought it said, 10:30 to about 11:30. If you are interested in helping out, we would love all the support. We need piano players, we need singers, we need preachers, amen. If you could all stand, if you could gather your tithe and your offering, amen, who's excited to give unto the Lord today? Amen. I'm so blessed we have the opportunity to put our finances into God's hand. Amen. Amen. Let's go before the Lord in prayer for this tithe and this offering. Amen. God, we love you. God, we're so thankful. God, for your goodness. God, your mercy. Lord, your everlasting kindness. God, I pray right now, Lord, for those who have to give, those who have not. I pray right now, Lord, you bless it for the work and purpose, God, of your kingdom today, God. And we're going to give you all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can march in the direction of your usher. We'll be right back.
breaking, strongholds are falling, and greater things are coming. I believe that.
For the victory we feel here in Jesus' name. Come on, one more time. Let's put our hands together for the Lord. He is worthy to be praised.
Amen. God is great and greatly to be praised. He deserves a great honor. Amen. Isn't he wonderful today? Aren't you glad you know him today? Aren't you glad you know the name of Jesus? That day or night you can call upon the name that's above every name. Hallelujah, and he can help you and touch you and transform you. Amen. Isn't it wonderful that we can worship the Lord like this? Amen. We can jump and shout and dance about and be apostolic. We had a great fellowship last night. We had about 40 of us gentlemen fellowship. We went to the Michigan game last night, watched Michigan play in Nebraska, and 107,000 people gather in that stadium, and they stand almost the whole game. They stand. They don't sit. They stand for four quarters. Amen. Amen. How much more exuberant should we be to worship the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the mighty God in Christ. Amen. I'm so glad I know him today. So glad to have each and every one of you here. We welcome our guests. We're so glad that our guests are. Grace, don't you love having guests in the church with us today? Amen. I love having you. Man, good to have Chase here. Chase goes to school with Lincoln, and they look like they could be brothers, really. So glad to have Chase here with us from Lutheran High Northwest. Thank you for being here, and all of our guests. We're so glad that you're here. If you're a guest with us, we'd love to get to know you better. There's outside in the lobby, we have a greeter's desk there. We would love to have maybe you can fill in some information for us. We have a gift for you to say thank you for being with us at Grace Apostolic Church. We know there's other churches you could be at. We're glad you're here today. We welcome all those that possibly are watching online. If you're watching us online, we greet you in the lovely name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Acts chapter 19. Good to have Sister Izzy here as well. She had kind of a at least 10 of us are happy. There's like 10 hands up there. Amen. Acts chapter 19, verse number 1. Thank you, praise team. Amen. We love our praise team, love our worship team, musicians. Verse number 1. And it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus, and finding certain disciples, these were believers, these were people that obviously were Christians, some some level in their walk with God. And he said unto them, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? They said unto him, we have not so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost. We don't even know what you're talking about. We have never heard of the Holy Ghost. And he said unto them, unto what then were you baptized? See, believers are baptized. Paul knew this. That's just part of, if you believe, you're baptized. He said, unto what then were you baptized? And they said, unto John's baptism. Then said Paul, John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto the people, they should believe on him which should come after him, that is, on Christ Jesus. In other words, John baptized in a certain way to prepare you for one that would come after him. When that one would come after him, he's the one you follow. You no longer follow me, I must decrease, he must increase. Of course, that one he's talking about is Jesus Christ. Then Paul begins to talk about Jesus. And when they heard this, they were baptized. Now you could almost put rebaptized. They were baptized once, and they were baptized again. But this time, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus, just like we do in 2022 at Grace Apostolic Church, 700 East Elmwood, and the waters behind that screen is waters. We baptize you the same way they baptize in the Bible, in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost, this thing he asked them, the Holy Ghost came on them, and they spake with tongues and prophesied, and all the men were about 12. Amen. They received the Holy Ghost once they were baptized in Jesus' name. Aren't you glad for the experience? The Holy Ghost experience, if you've never yet experienced it, is the greatest thing that mankind will ever experience on this side of glory. Amen. The baptism of the Holy Ghost, and it's for you today. Amen. It is an absolute promise of God. If God said it, you can have it today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I want to talk to you and just borrowing from Paul what Paul already said, simply on this subject, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? Amen. It's a question that needs to be answered. Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? Everyone say amen to reading the Word. You may be seated. For some in this room today, this topic of receiving the Holy Ghost after believing may be a revelatory topic. Maybe something you've never heard before. Perhaps someone watching online decided, I'm going to check out what those apostolics are all about and see kind of what they do in their church and how they preach. And some of them possibly have never heard of the Holy Ghost like these gentlemen in the book of Acts had never heard of the Holy Ghost. I remember doing a Bible study with Kim and Sammy years ago. And Kim asked, well, how come my pastor never told us about this? I said, I don't know. I don't know why some people have not heard, because it's in the Word of God. It's all in the Word of God. So some people today, the subject of receiving the Holy Ghost, evidence of speaking of the tongues, may be revelatory, but I assume for the majority of us, we are familiar with what I'm preaching on. This subject is nothing new to you, perhaps. It's just sharpening of your sword today. It's something you're already familiar with. You already have 10 chapters or 10 verses in your mind you can go to when speaking about receiving the Holy Ghost, but it's just kind of a review for some. This is a salvation message if you haven't known that already. This is absolutely about if you're lost and you want to be saved, you want to open up your ears and hear what I'm getting ready to tell you today. It's a salvation message. But the reason, even though it may be common to some of you, the reason it must be preached again, see, we're the most preached at people in all the face of the earth. I promise you, apostolics, you are preached to on a regular basis. You preach that on Sundays and Wednesdays and all your camp meetings and conferences. I promise you, you've been preached to. So why again do we preach something that's so common to us that we've heard so many times? Is because the importance is that we must understand that in an effort for us to try to hear something that has never been heard before, Right, we try to we're excited by someone bringing something to the pulpit that we say I've never heard that before. In fact, I can preach Acts 2:38 and no one says anything to me about that. Maybe, you know, whatever. But if I say something they never heard before, man, I've never seen that before. Because we're excited by something that we've never heard or never read or something, because it is something new to us. But we must make sure and understand that in our effort to preach something that has never been heard before, that we understand that no idea or no new thought will ever trump the message of salvation. No revelation you hear, nothing that a prophet speaks, nothing that could ever be brought across the pulpit can be any more important than the same message of salvation. Okay, we can never move beyond that and say, you know, anything's better than that. In fact, in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, 1 through 4, Paul talks about things he had seen in the spirit. He said, whether in the body or out, I don't know. It's a vision I've seen, but the Lord took me someplace. He talks about his visions and being caught up into the third heaven. And he talks about he was in paradise. And he said, I heard unspeakable words which are not lawful to utter. I heard things so far up in the third heavens that I can't even speak those right here on earth. You wouldn't be able to handle that. But I promise you, if some preacher came along and said, hey, the Lord has given me a revelation on the unspeakable words of Paul, and we're going to do a series on that here at Grace Apostolic Church. If you want to know what it is, I promise you, you might be able to fill up a church. Because it's new. It's something we want to hear revelation. But if that same preacher came by and says, you know what, we're going to do a series on the gospel. We're going to talk 3 days about the gospel. Come out and hear something about the gospel. We might struggle to fill up a few pews because we know the gospel, but we're drawn to things we have never heard before because we just like to hear new things. But it's the gospel that saves us. It's the gospel that gives us hope. It's the gospel that allows us to say, I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was a drug addict. I was an abuser of myself. But praise God. Thank God for baptism in Jesus' name. Thank the Lord for repentance. Thank the Lord for the Holy Ghost. Thank you for the death, burial, and resurrection. Thank God for the gospel. See, the gospel is like the foundation of a house. No one ever invites you over to their new house to check out their foundation. Come on over to our house. We're just moved in. We want to show you the foundation. Look at all the cement. I promise you, if you want to know about a foundation, I've got a foundation underneath my garage. It's like this wide. Guy took a big old bucket and filled the whole thing with cement. About 4 feet by... It ain't going anywhere. It's going nowhere. It's there, the foundation. But look at my beautiful garage. But I want to show you the foundation. No one ever gets excited about the foundation. Everybody wants to see what? They want to see the beautiful flooring. They want to see the beautiful tile work that Brother Curtin put in for them. They want to show you all the beautiful things on the floors because that's what people are drawn to. People are drawn to things that are beautiful and the chandeliers, all these beautiful things. But if you have a foundation problem, if you have something wrong with the foundation, it doesn't matter how beautiful each floor is. It doesn't matter how beautiful the tile work or how beautiful the flooring is. It's all going to crumble without the proper foundation. Listen, folks, let's not worry about some new revelation. Let's not follow some man around the country because they have something new you never heard before. I'm telling you, if you want to be excited, let's be excited that we're based on the right foundation.
that Jesus Christ is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Let's still be excited about repentance and water baptism in Jesus' name. Let's still be excited about speaking in other tongues. Let's get excited about the foundation by which we stand today. Amen. That's why Paul wrote in Romans 1:16, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes." Who believes the gospel, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. If we believe the gospel, we will repent of our sins, as Brother James said. If we believe the gospel, we will be water baptized in the only name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. If we believe the gospel, we will go on to pray for the Holy Ghost, and we will speak with other tongues as the Spirit gives the utterance. Why? Because the gospel still works. It is not outdated. It has not lost its power. It's still as real as it's ever been. Upon his journey to preach Christ among his, wherever he can go, Paul stumbles upon some young disciples in the city of Ephesus. And they said this is where kind of where the church of Ephesus began, with these 12 disciples. In fact, and it also talks about Apollos in Ephesus and Aquila and Priscilla. But he comes to these young disciples, these young men that are excited about God and doing something for God. And it must have been through conversation that Paul recognized these disciples don't have full truth. You don't talk to somebody for very long and you know where they are with God. You say whether or not they have an understanding of certain things. And so Paul, because he knows, recognized there's something missing in their walk. Now, we never destroy anyone's walk with God. We never ever make fun of someone because they don't have maybe full understanding. We celebrate any part of walk with God that you've got. We celebrate those things because we know that we if we're on our journey, that all of us are on a different journey with God. But he recognizes something about these young men, and he asks them a point blank question. Either you are or you're not. We can't just pause here and say, well, I live in gray area. It's either one or the other. Either you have or you have not. And so he asked them a point-blank question: have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe? Now, it's either you have or you haven't. And Paul is not asking this question to be cantankerous. He's not just trying to be some, you know, he's not trying to be confrontational here. He wouldn't think that this would be confrontational. Why is it so confrontational today? There was no other understanding. It just was. It is. It's truth or it's untruth. It's full truth or it's not full truth. Whatever it is, he wasn't trying to be passive aggressive. Have you received the Holy Ghost? I'm not going to tell you you're wrong, but I'm just going to ask you a question. He wasn't trying to be passive aggressive with his question. You know, imagine the question. How that question would go over today in modern churches this afternoon. If you were to walk down, good service, pastor, but I want to ask you, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? A lot of churches would say, you're being passive aggressive. A lot of churches would say, you're being cantankerous. Of course we've not. We don't believe in that stuff. We don't believe in that whole Holy Ghost business. But Paul asked this question to these disciples because there was no other way to be saved but through water baptism in Jesus' name and through the gift of the Holy Ghost in Paul's mind. Now, this is Paul that wrote Romans, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, right? Possibly Hebrews. We know what this man believes. So anytime you read in some book that Paul wrote and it contradicts what you believe, you better go back to the beginning of Paul, who he was as a man, and what he believed. If what he writes is contradictory to his own experience, there's something wrong there. So Paul writes this because Paul really understood to fully believe in Christ and to have Christ-centered biblical salvation, you would be obedient to the Word of God by repenting of your sins, by being baptized in Jesus' name, and by praying until you receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, and you know you have the Holy Ghost by speaking in other tongues. It is the initial sign that you receive the Holy Ghost. We don't chase tongues. We chase God, and God fills with the Holy Ghost. And the evidence is I began to speak with other tongues. Jesus said in John chapter 3, verse 5, except a man be born again of water and spirit. Water and spirit. Some of you, I sent you a text last night. Anybody get that text last night? I sent you a text last night. Man, the guy was refuting absolutely the necessity of water baptism. He's saying when you're born of water, you're born of the natural mother's water. You have to be born. Why? Then why would Jesus say you got to be born again? Man, that doesn't even make sense to me. It's not about being born of water of the mother. You've got to be born again. Jesus said, marvel not, you must be born again of water and of the Spirit. And Peter in Acts chapter 2, verse 38, responds to what Jesus says when the men and the women said, men and brethren, what shall we do? That Peter said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Everyone wants to be saved. Everyone wants to go to heaven, but the question is, have you been obedient to the book? Have you been born again? Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? There has ever only been one way that people were baptized in the Bible. It was in the name of Jesus Christ. In fact, if they were not baptized in that name, they were rebaptized in the name of Jesus Christ, like these 12 young men were here, these disciples of John. Hence, when Paul realized they hadn't received the Holy Ghost, he asked them, unto what then were you baptized? Because if you're a believer, you get baptized. Knew they had to be baptized by something. How you are baptized matters. God never meant this topic to be ambiguous. He never meant this to be to your own private interpretation. The truth of the matter is anyone ever baptized in the New Testament was only ever baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. These young men were rebaptized. They've been baptized once. Should I be baptized again? Have you been baptized in Jesus' name? No. Let's baptize you again, right? They were rebaptized in the name of Jesus, and they received the gift of the Holy Ghost. In Mark chapter 16:16, Jesus said, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. In Acts 18:8, the Bible says, and Crispus, the chief ruler of the synagogue, believed on the Lord with all of his house, and many of the Corinthians hearing believed. That's great. That's wonderful. That's amazing. And were baptized. They did not stop their journey with Jesus at believing. They did not leave the synagogue saying, man, I'm so glad I believe now. I didn't believe before, but praise God, I'm in the family. No, when they believed what they heard, they followed with obedience by being baptized in Jesus' name. In Acts chapter 8, Philip meets a eunuch out in a desert place. He hears the man in his chariot reading from the scripture in Isaiah 53, reading the story of a lamb, the man who was a lamb before his shears was dumb, so he opened not his mouth. And Philip, the Spirit tells Philip, join yourself to that man. And Philip, hearing this man read the scriptures, says, understandest without readest. And the man said, how can I? I'm frustrated. How can I understand unless some man show me? And he moves up and gets in the chariot with him and begins to share it with him the word. And the eunuch says, tell me, who's this man speaking of? Is he speaking of himself, or is he speaking of some other man? And the Bible says that Philip, in verse 34, opened up his mouth and began to preach Christ unto him. Now, in verse 36, the Bible says, as they went on their way, how long did they talk for? How long did Philip reason with this young man for? How long? This man had no idea about anything in the scripture. And lo and behold, God sends one man out to a desert place. I promise you, folks, if you're hungry for God, God will bring a man out into your desert place. You think you're out there all by yourself. If you have a hunger for God, God will bring someone with truth along your way. And you may not know how it's going to happen, but I'm telling you, God will never leave anybody that's hungry empty. Amen? Amen. So here comes Philip preaching to him. They're talking along their way, and I don't know how long they talked and discussed, but this man went from knowing nothing, but he heard about Jesus. And verse 36 of that same verse, and as they went on their way, they came into a certain water, and the eunuch said, see, here's water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? The eunuch brought it up. Somehow, the name of Jesus and being baptized is correlated together. The only way the eunuch would want to know to go to the water is because he understood the name of Jesus must be applied upon me in the water. That's why the eunuch, when he sees in the middle of all this desert, he sees, hey, there's some water here. He asks Philip, what doth hinder me? It was the eunuch's idea. It was the man that just had gotten a Bible study, or received a Bible study from the man of God. He's so excited. He said, I'm not going to wait till camp meeting. I'm not going to wait till the next Sabbath. I'm not going to wait till I get maybe down the road. He said, man, if I see the word of God, I want to do it right now. Perhaps we have this wrong. Perhaps the way we work with people and teach Bible studies is wrong. See, because we teach people Bible studies, and we show them the truth of God's word, and then we have to prod them for an hour, a couple days, or a week. I just taught you a Bible study. Don't you think getting baptized would be a good idea now? Come on, come to church. We'll baptize you right now. Well, I don't know. I just, you know. And so we teach them the word of God. We show them the importance of the water baptism for the washing away of sins, and then we still have to pull them. Philip didn't have to pull the eunuch out of his, you see what I'm saying? Listen, this is not my salvation I'm talking about. I've already been through the water. I've got the Holy Ghost. But man, if you're not saved, if you've never been baptized in Jesus' name, you shouldn't have to be prodded. You should be looking for a man of God saying, hey, I want to get baptized right now. I want my sins washed away right now. I need a man of God. I see it. I receive it. I'm moving forward in it. I love the story of Bishop L.A. Parent, my great-grandfather, out there in some cold place in Canada, New Brunswick, in his kitchen reading the Word of God. He already had the Holy Ghost. But he looked at his wife and said, Ida, I'm in this, but I'm not in this correctly. He said, I must be baptized in Jesus' name. At that point in time, there was no man in the New Brunswick area that would baptize that man, but he was so hungry that he found his way out in the woods somewhere by a little cold creek there and put his hand in that cold water and said, Lord, let this be my baptism till someone will baptize me. Let me tell you, folks, we're not in New Brunswick. We're not in the 1920s. We've got warm water up there. I don't know what would keep you from being baptized. Everything you need is in the house of God today. I must be born again. So Philip says, if you believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. And he said, the eunuch said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Both went down into the water and he was baptized. His baptism was the result of his believing. Receiving the Holy Ghost is the result of you believing. Let me say this right now. Believing is not salvation. Just because you believe on the Lord, the devils also believe and tremble. Belief is not salvation. However, some people have built a monument at believing. They have built the principle that you're saved for eternity because you accept and believe on Jesus. Believing is not salvation, but it is the door that leads you to salvation. Confessing Christ as your Lord and Savior will not save you. But if you believe on the Lord in your heart, you will do what His Word says in order to be saved. Because I believe on Jesus, because I believe the Word of God, I will repent of my sins. I will go upstairs and I will change my clothes. I will get into some baptismal garments. I will let the man of God put me in the water. I will be baptized in Jesus' name. I will pray. I will receive the Holy Ghost. Why? Because I believe on Jesus. And because I believe on Him, I walk through the door of salvation. Because I realize I can't stop at believing. I must do something with what I know now. Acts chapter 16. Isn't this exciting? Man, this is I'm sorry. I don't know. Paul and Silas are in Acts chapter 16 thrown into prison. And they're beaten because they... You want to talk about messed up society? They're beaten for releasing a girl of her demonic spirits. How would you like that for a society to live in? Because she was a soothsayer, they prayed the devil out of her, and because of that, all those that had much gain by her soothsaying were so upset they bring Paul and Silas to the magistrates. They beat Paul and Silas, and they throw them into the inner prison, and they charge the jailer to keep them safe. And because of that, the jailer put them into the very inner parts of the prison. And we know the Bible says that Paul and Silas were in their prison at midnight, and the Bible said they began to sing and pray unto God and sing praise unto God. The other inmates heard them sing, and because of their praise, the Bible says a great earthquake shook the prison. The doors were open. All the chains, the bands were loose upon the prisoners. And the jail keeper awakens out of his sleep and he sees all the doors open. He's so scared that he's going to fall upon his own sword, thinking he had been a dereliction of his duty, that perhaps he was in such a deep sleep that somehow someone came in and rescued these people away. And Paul, knowing what he was going to do to him, says, "Do yourself no harm. We're all here. We're still here." And he takes a lantern, springing in unto them, sees that Paul and Silas are still there, and he falls at their feet and realizes these men are men of God. And verse 27 says, "And the keeper of the prison, awaking out of his sleep and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice and saying, 'Do thyself no harm, for we are all here.'" Then he called, I'm getting ready to quit, by the way. "Then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, 'Sirs, it's the question of the generation. What must I do to be saved?'" It's a question we hear throughout the scriptures. What must we do? What must I do to be saved? And Paul responds with where everybody believes and everybody builds their monuments around. He says, and they said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy house." And everybody stops right there.
So many people say, see, in fact, that text I sent you guys, he uses this as a place where only believing in Christ is enough to be saved. Because Paul said that, right? But Paul didn't stop with that. You've got to believe on the Lord with all your heart. That's the door that gets you to salvation, to get you to salvation. If you believe on the Lord with all your heart, it doesn't matter all the things you don't get, you're going to keep walking. Why? Because you're going to bump into salvation. Why? Because you love the Lord with all your heart. And you keep on moving through obedience to the place of salvation. And then he says, verse number 32, and they spake and they kept preaching. We don't know what they said to him. We don't know all the words. They just kept preaching him the word of God. Now, if all he had to do is believe, they're done. We got to go to the next town over, but we're done. But they stayed with him. They stayed with him. They spake unto him the word of the Lord and to all that were in his house. And he took them that same hour of the night and washed their stripes and was baptized, he and all his straightway. Somewhere, the belief on Jesus and the continuation of the Bible study that Paul and Silas gave him made him realize, I'm not letting these men leave my house until they have baptized us. Why? Because if I believe, I will be baptized. If you've never been baptized in Jesus' name, I wouldn't wait another day. I'd say, Lord Jesus, I'm so thankful a man of God preached it. I have got to be baptized in Jesus' name. Let's all stand to our feet. A man with experience is never at the mercy of a man with an argument. It was, I think, Bishop Haywood that when he got baptized and received the Holy Ghost, someone, one of his friends came and said, man, Bishop, stay away from those people, those crazy apostolics. I'm going to try to baptize you. Jesus, try to get you the Holy Ghost. He says, brother, it's too late. I'm one of them. There shall be light in the evening time. Right? Mighty God and Christ are one. I'm so thankful for the revelation I have. Folks, you better sharpen your swords. You better have an answer. The worst thing is for you to declare you know what the truth is and you believe the truth, but you can't defend it. Now, as we say, the truth will defend itself. The word of God is true, and every man's a liar, okay? That was some good effects right there. That was the Holy Ghost out of that piano, I think. You better know what the word of God says. You better know how to handle yourself in the word of God. I'm telling you, we're coming to a day where people don't want people to say, well, I believe, but I don't know it. You better know it. You better sharpen your swords. You better know the word of God. We're coming too late in the hour for us to sit around and be empty-headed Christians that sit on the pew day in, day out and never let it get in your mind, your heart. You ought to turn off your device until you can quote some scripture about the one God. You ought to set them down until you can tell me why I should be baptized, why we have the Holy Ghost. All those things, we got to know those things, folks. Because it's those things that make the difference in eternity. Today, if you've never repented of your sins, you've never been baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of those sins, if you've never received the Holy Ghost, evidence of speaking in the tongues, today is a great day. We encourage, if you want to be baptized, right behind that screen, there's waters there. We'll baptize you in Jesus' name. It takes 15 minutes. And all your sins are washed away. And man, if you've ever received the Holy Ghost, what a beautiful day it is. It's a gift of God. It's not of the devil. It's not evil. It's a great gift that God has given us. I'm so glad I was baptized in water and spirit. Today can be the day for someone. Amen. Amen. As you know, we open up these altars. We believe in responding to the word of God. They're going to sing something, going to play something, and we're going to open up these altars. If you want to come down and love God, you can respond today with coming down this altar. Let's come down. Let's love God right now. Let's lift up our voice and praise unto him. If you already know this truth, why don't you give God a praise for it? Lord, I'm so thankful today. I'm so thankful I know who Jesus is. I'm so thankful I know you, Lord. Oh, God, I'm so thankful my sins have been washed away. Come on, let us respond.
I just want
speak the name of Jesus.
I don't want it to ever grow old in me, Lord Jesus.
Over every heart and every mind.
Lord, it's the power of God and it's salvation, Lord.
Because I know there is peace within your presence.
I want the Holy Ghost.
I speak Jesus.
Break every storm, Lord, shine through.